kept playing him in the Soviet Union. And yet, this man who contributed around 300 pieces to the piano literature was a neglected composer until around 1969, when interest began again in relation to this enigmatic human being who thought of himself as the Messiah. Well, I first came in contact with Scriabin around 1954 when I was studying piano with a fellow by the name of James Stream, who is now professor of piano at Florida State University. I was, I think, around 14 years old, and I just couldn't believe the impact of this music. My whole body trembled when I heard it. It seems to me that many people who have the Scriabinic bug are very affected by his music. I've seen people's nostrils twitch and faint away, and I mean it. And there are many examples of this kind of state of consciousness which his music breeds. Well, I went to Juilliard, and again, Scriabin was not very well known. Fellow by the name of Ronald Rogers was practicing the fourth sonata in his practice room. And that's how I met this person, because I was enchanted by this work I had not known. Previously, I knew very little of the music. Now I vowed I must hear more. But there was no way, because pianists weren't playing them. Oh, Ronnie, I listened to Ron play this and practice it and other Scriabin works. Then I lost track of him, and then I found out that Ronald, who was one of the most superb talents at Juilliard, became stricken with multiple sclerosis. And fortunately, he made some recordings of his live performances at Juilliard. And so many people at that school started hearing and assessing this composer through his playing. Ronald had studied with many fine teachers, and one great influence on his life was the wonderful pianist Ted Sadlovsky. Well, Ron doesn't play now because the multiple sclerosis still exists. But these recordings of certain Scriabin pieces that he played so well from live performance shows at the age of 25 what a reckless, daring, and coloristic talent Ron Rogers possessed. Let's hear Ronald Rogers perform Des Airs, the etude in D sharp minor, the celebrated one, opus 8, number 12, and the fourth sonata, opus 30. Here is Ronald Rogers. live performance of De Zaire, the Scriabin B-sharp minor etude, and the fourth sonata of the same composer by Ronald Rogers in live performance at Juilliard School, and that was where I first heard the fourth sonata, listening to him practice in his practice room, figuring out those amazingly difficult passages in both hands, the vertiginous, ecstatic states of Scriabin, prestissimo volando, flying. And Scriabin was someone that really thought he could fly. In fact, he thought he was the Messiah. We'll talk more about this composer, this enigmatic, symbolist, mystic, romanticist, expressionist, right after this message. And we are back with more Scriabin. Scriabin, S-C-R-I-A-B-I-N. Sometimes it's spelled different ways. S-K-R-I-A-B-I-N, sometimes in England. Alexander Nikolaevich Scriabin. He was born on Christmas Day in 1872, and that had significance for him because Scriabin became one of the most egomaniacal human beings that ever penned music. In fact, he later thought that he was the Messiah. World War I, when it came about, was to purify the world for his music. He took himself vastly seriously, studied theosophy and other occult and esoteric philosophies. In his early work, he was dandified almost in his imitation of Chopin, and yet he is strangely individual, even as early as Opus 8. The etude you heard before in D-sharp minor has so much of Chopin, and yet, again, this feeling of Scriabin. The fourth sonata enters a period of transition where he is building his kind of harmonic palette and moving along a more chromatic range, Lisztian and Wagnerian indeed, and you heard in the opening of the fourth sonata a Tristan and Isolde kind of chromaticism. He also had, from Liszt, a kind of diabolism, but in a more sarcastic, ironic vein, and we heard the fourth sonata's kind of erotic, vertiginous tendencies. Let's hear by Sofronitsky, Scriabin's son-in-law, though he never knew him. He died before he married his daughters. The satanic poem, another element in Scriabinists, this satanism. In this case, it is almost an ironic kind. You'll hear it. Thank you. was Alexander Sofronitsky, pianist who died in 1960, who had married Scriabin's daughter, though he never knew the composer, playing the satanic poem, Opus 36. And as you may hear, Scriabin carries the diabolical kind of Lisztian mood, such as in the Mephisto Waltz, into a much more esoteric, more personal vein. There certainly is an irony and a devilish laughter almost, and a certain nervosity, this nervous energy, this almost bitter languor, which would continue in his works up to the end, one writer calling it nervous magic. And we'll hear the fifth sonata after this message. And we all return to hear more of Scriabin's music. He was a child prodigy, as many composers and instrumentalists have been. His father was in the military and was an engineer. His mother died when he was a year old. She was the great talent, the genetic inheritance which would create a Scriabin. She had nervous sensibility. She was an extraordinarily fine pianist, Moscow Conservatory product, and a pupil of the great pedagogue Leschetizky. Anton Rubinstein thought of her as a fine pianist. She married very quickly after the conservatory. There is an extant program of her, a recital program, and then she became pregnant, and Scriabin came on Christmas Day. She died very soon after. Scriabin, wherever he went, took the portrait of a strangely enchanting-looking woman, his mother, and always this portrait was with him. He never knew her, but this, of course, was the monumental direction he would go in the world of piano playing, through his mother's inspiration, in a sense. Two aunts so doted upon the young boy that Scriabin was a rarefied child of utterly high sensibilities, high-strung, nervous to the extreme, spoiled. Physically, he was tiny and very fastidious, a trait which would become almost insanely neurasthenic as he grew older. He wouldn't touch money because of the germs. He wouldn't touch phones because of the germs. Scriabin was extremely neurotic, to say the least. Add to that his theories of himself as a messiah, and you had a very difficult man to talk to. However, talking to Scriabin was not where it was at, for as a pianist, he was an absolute god. Joseph Hoffman said he learned how to pedal from hearing Scriabin. Rachmaninoff thought of him as a wonderful pianist. Went to the Moscow Conservatory. He left without his composer's diploma because Arensky, his teacher, couldn't understand his high-strung spoiledness, so that didn't work out. However, later he taught there. He was a horrendous teacher because teaching or any possible mundane chore was odious to the extreme to Scriabin. His music was precocious, and at 14 he wrote the famous C-sharp minor etude, which we'll hear on another program. But today we've been listening to some middle period works, the Des Airs and the Fourth Sonata, the Satanic Poem. And let's move a little more into this ecstatic state of consciousness which he was moving toward in his orchestral work, the Poem of Ecstasy. An outgrowth of this work, the Poem of Ecstasy, his Fourth Symphony, is his Fifth Piano Sonata. And here you have a motto on the cover of the work, summoning the release of an unconscious force, states which the composer called mystical. There's a part of this motto from his Poem of Ecstasy. He wrote a poem for it, and it talks about spiders and snakes and erotic symbols. and mythology and so forth. Well, listen to the way Horowitz plays the opening, because it is truly this summoning of unconsciousness, and listen to how the work becomes, well, later this, the theme becomes, in Scriabin's words, love play, this nervosity, this magic energy. It just zoomed out of him in an inspiration. This work, Scriabin said, I didn't know how it came about. It just flowed out of him. Aaron Copland once said, Scriabin is one of the great examples in music of pure inspiration. And what a composer for the piano. He just makes it speak. Listen now to Horowitz in the Fifth Sonata.
Thank you.
It's an amazing work, Scriabin's Fifth Sonata, in an amazing performance by Horowitz. Right after this message, we'll hear one short piece more, and that will be it for today's Scriabinic adventure. Let's conclude today's program on Scriabin's piano music with a performance by Sofronitsky of a 50-second piece composed in the same year as the Sonata No. 5 you just heard, again typifying this composer's desire to fly, to have movement, to have light. He was obsessed with light and fire. This little piece is called The Winged Poem. Here it is. Sofronitsky took us on that little flight in The Winged Poem with a beautiful little landing. That's enough for Scriabin today. Next time, more of his output from all three of his periods. Like Beethoven, he is a composer who had an early period, a derivative one from Chopin, a middle period where he's finding his wings, and in his case, a very far out, at least for the teens of this century, a very far out third period. In fact, he was called in the 60s the first flower child in music. This is David Dubal for The Love of Music. Thank you very much.
For The Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For The Love of Music is produced by